Good afternoon, all of you. We are just going to touch upon important aspects of systematic reviews and meta-analysis. Today, we'll try to understand the principles of systematic review, learn processes of designing, how to design a systematic review, understand important components of critical appraisal of the systematic review, which is the most important part of the systematic review, and learn that how do we apply systematic review to our practice. In my opinion, we all are academicians and we all are researchers. The day we took medicine, we decided we are going to study throughout our lives. And since we are studying, we are all academicians. And we all are dealing with research papers from two perspectives, either from the perspective of writing a research paper and doing a research, or putting the research into practice, which is also a very important part of the research. Those of us who are not writing papers are also a very important part of this network, because you are applying knowledge to practice. Whatever is being published, whatever is being researched, unless that is useful enough to be put into practice and has been used by the people across the globe, it's of little meaning. And through this presentation on systematic reviews and meta-analysis, I would also like to emphasize upon how should we use the existing knowledge to change a practice, or how the existing knowledge can form a part of a practice. Initially, there was a problem of scarcity. There was hardly any literature available on most of the medical topics. We didn't know where to start, what to use in a day-to-day practice. But now there's a problem of access. More than 10 lakh articles are published in more than 20,000 journals each year, and it has still left us confused what should be the best thing, what should be the best color to use in my painting now. So there has been an exponential increase in medical literature over the last few years, which makes us wonder that is all of this right? No, not all. Obviously, if everything else was right, if everything was black and white, we wouldn't be standing here discussing research methodology here. It would have been it would have been like a gospel. You just accept that, whatever is written there. But no, it's not like that. We have to critically appraise. We have to really, from the existing knowledge, we'll have to separate the trash from the good, and finally make the use of the good to change a practice. We have been seeing this pyramid right from the morning, and I hope we all are quite familiar with this now. So systematic reviews and meta-analysis, they form the tip of this pyramid. They stand at the top of this pyramid. So they should be considered to be the best level of evidence. But to be the best, they should have been carried out in the best way. So just reading a systematic review and meta-analysis is not enough. Just seeing that a systematic review or meta-analysis is written in the title of an article is not enough. When we are reading that article, we have to look at the design of the systematic review and meta-analysis to be sure that it has been carried out in the way in which it was supposed to be carried out, in order to be good enough to be used in the best way. So although they enjoy the top level of evidence, they should be carried out more diligently and much effort with all the principles that are used that form a part of this review. I'll skip this. Now, if we see a review article is absolutely different from a systematic review. A review article, a simple narrative review, that is basically an author's perspective of the situation. It may cover a broader scenario of the problem. For example, if there's a review article on Perthes disease, it may cover on etiology, epidemiology, treatment, diagnosis, radiology, everything about the Perthes disease, but it may not be evidence-based. When we say systematic review, it is evidence-based. Evidence-based in the sense that it will cover only one part of Perthes disease most of the times, maybe just the treatment of Herring's B and C Perthes disease. That's all it's going to cover. Or comparing surgical versus non-surgical treatment in particular class of the disease. It's not going to cover more than that, but it is going to examine all the available evidence in all sorts of literature reviews in order to address that one problem and finally give you a solution, or may not give you a solution to that problem. It may just say that evidence is not sufficient to give you a right answer. But that is the answer to that problem, that evidence is not sufficient. Maybe you need to generate more evidence, or maybe more research has to be carried out, or maybe the topic is such that it may not be possible to comment to give one particular answer to that problem. So what are the shortcomings of a traditional review? It lacks explicit methodology. Methodology. We are in a research methodology workshop. We have to work methodologically. It's biased by the personal opinion of the author. All studies may be given equal weightage. Stress may be on the positive outcomes, and it does not combine results. Systematic review and meta-analysis, it addresses a specific research question using explicit methodology of collecting, selecting, and appraising the studies, and whenever appropriate, synthesizing the results together. So it is basically a study of studies conducted on the same topic and population with the same method. So same topic and population is important. If you are looking at Perthes disease between 8 to 10 years of age in the herrings B and C, we have to include only the studies which are including children between 8 to 10 years of age in the herrings grade B and C. We are not going to take the studies on adult onset Perthes, on the Perthes in children less than 6 years of age, or any other age group, or Perthes only in females, or maybe the Perthes in herrings A. Another very important part of systematic review is that it is systematic. It is systematic means it is carried out using a systematic methodology, which makes it reproducible. Anybody across the globe should be able to carry out the same systematic review using the methodology that you have written in your research paper and get the same results that you have got in your research paper. That's what I mean by reproducible. And if possible, you can also statistically combine the results of two or more studies to address the same research question, in which it will be called the meta-analysis. Meta-analysis may be a component of the systematic review when it is possible to combine the results. Again, the very commonly used phrase in meta-analysis, you always combine apples with apples and oranges with oranges. Don't combine oranges with apples. So whatever you are combining should be comparable. Whatever you are combining should be same, similar. So systematic review focuses on a well-defined research question, clearly states the titles and objectives of the review. There's a comprehensive literature search, explicit definition of inclusion and exclusion criteria. Critical appraisal of the studies is included, which is again missing in the narrative reviews. There's a clear analysis of the results of eligible studies and a structured report. We have been seeing this since morning: ask, acquire, appraise, and apply, and access. These five A's, they are components of evidence-based medicine. And now that pyramid was also of basically evidence-based medicine, since systematic reviews form the tip of the evidence-based medicine, they have to follow these principles utmost diligently. So ask is basically forming a research question. So research question and research protocol is the basic of this thing, forming a systematic review. So it has to start with a written protocol in which you are defining your research question. Asking a clinical question which has to be well formulated. There has to be a predefined question with defined outcomes. You may define your primary and secondary outcomes, and your study will basically be based on your primary outcomes. For example, if we have this scenario, there's a 60-year-old Mr. Sharma who has got a fall and sustained comminuted intertrochanteric fracture of right femur. You wish to know whether nailing or DHS would be the treatment of choice for him. We follow the PICO format. So the patient here is a comminuted intertrochanteric fracture in a male. Intervention here is the surgical treatment. The control would be the DHS, and intervention would be the surgical treatment using intramedullary nail. Control would be the DHS, and outcome would be the functional outcome scores of fracture healing. So our search should be based on the PICO format. We have to formulate the keywords here. I'm sorry, there's a mistake in the CNO. I'll just ignore the slide. Just be with me what I'm speaking. So there's a comminuted intertrochanteric fracture. Now we have to formulate the keywords for a next search. The search has to be carried out using the keywords. See, this search is basically what we are doing when we are doing systematic reviews. But this is also helpful to you when you are searching a particular clinical question that you have got with you and you are trying to finding an answer from a database. So again, if you are searching on a database using non-specific terminologies and non-specific items, you will get non-specific answers. I mean, your search results would be non-specific. You have to be quite specific and to the point if you are actually searching for a question of your individual interest. So there could be hip fractures, proximal femur fractures, and IT fractures. The word mesh search was used in the morning, which stands for medical subheadings, which basically is a vocabulary or is a dictionary which the PubMed uses. So PubMed will identify, how will the database identify the articles that are indexed with it? It's going to use certain words, which are the keywords, which are the keywords of that particular article. And if you enter a keyword on the database, it is going to pick up those articles and give it to you. Okay, so MeSH is a language which PubMed understands. It is a dictionary or the vocabulary of the PubMed. So if you put the right keywords, you are going to get the right search items. So the comminuted intertrochanteric fractures, other possibilities could be hip fractures or proximal femur fractures or IT fractures. So put all them in your MeSH items. Surgical treatment, other alternatives may be intervention, surgery, treatment, intermedullary nails, DHS, hip screw, sliding screw, fracture union, functional outcomes, which are obviously combined together using Boolean operators or AND. But what is the best study designed to answer this clinical question from the audience? So would you agree with me if I say it's a randomized controlled trial? Prospective cohort, okay, yes. To start with, maybe a prospective cohort, but what would be a better level of evidence than a prospective cohort? And what would be a better level of evidence than a randomized controlled trial? A meta-analysis of randomized controlled trials would be the best evidence to answer this clinical question. So this is where you are going to search, and to search the MeSH terms, there is an option on the PubMed if you go for the MeSH search. One of the speakers did show this in the morning. So that is how you are going to acquire the best evidence. We have been discussing this, Medline, Embase are important, but hand search is still the gold standard. It will give you the maximum number of outputs. So even after Medline, Embase, and Cochrane search, which someone said in the morning will give you 94% of the search results, hand search again is important. So check the references cited in each article. Now shortlisting the studies for inclusion. Now you have entered the search terms, you have got 2,500 articles on the PubMed that deals with this question. Okay, so as I said, there's information access now. Now you have to go into sieve this information to get things of your interest and things of your choice which are going to matter to you. So there has to be a quick and informal reading of the titles and abstract of the articles to start with. It will screen out a large number of articles which are not useful to you because either they may be biomechanical studies, they may be cadaveric studies, they may be case series, they may be studies with lower level of evidence, there may be studies which are not in English language and may not be accessible to you, which you may like to exclude, although that may not be ideal all the times. And after a quick and informal reading, then the second step would be a detailed and a formal reading in which not only the abstracts but the full text of the articles would also have to be searched. So that is a step two where you will narrow down. PRISMA statement is something which you should be aware when you're talking about systematic review. That is another target of my talk. I want to make you aware of the terms that you will encounter when you're reading a systematic review or a meta-analysis. So PRISMA statement is basically a preferred reporting items for systematic reviews and meta-analysis. It consists of a 27 item checklist and a flow diagram which will tell you that all these steps should have been followed before a systematic review was completed. So whenever you have got a systematic review which is published, and if you put it on this holy grail of Prisma, you should be able to see that all the steps which are enumerated in the Prisma checklist should have been followed if the systematic review is right. If it is, it has not been followed, it has omitted a number of steps, then probably it is not the level one evidence. Okay, although it is calling itself a systematic review, but it's not a systematic review, or it has not been done in a systematic way. So this is how a Prisma statement would look like, in which, can I use this pointer? Okay, so this is how it will look like, in which there will be initial identification of the studies. It will give you a large number of results. For example, in this example, there are around 12,000 results. So there may be a lot of duplicates because you have used a lot of search engines, and you also use hand search. After removing duplicates, you have done the initial screening. On the initial screening, you will exclude a large number of articles. Maybe 90% of the articles may not be relevant to you once you do the initial screening. And after doing the initial screening, you will narrow down on the articles which you are going to read in detail. There are few of them, but they'll consume all of your time. So if you are excluding some free tests, kindly give reasons why you have excluded them. And finally, if you are including certain number of studies which are meeting the inclusion and exclusion criteria laid down in your systematic review, you are going to narrow down on them. This is one of the examples which we have done, in which you excluded the various records. That is just that if you are excluding the results, kindly enumerate that why you are excluding these studies, so that the person who is reading it, since we call it as a systematic, the other person should be able to replicate this. So the third step, which is again the most common step, most important step of a systematic review, that stands a systematic review totally away from a normal narrative review, is a critical appraisal of the literature. See, this is important again, not only from the point of view of writing a systematic review, but also from the point of view of reading a research article. Whenever you are reading a research article, you should be able to critically appraise it in order to ensure that whether you can use this information or not. Okay. So are all systematic reviews level 1 evidence? Are all RCTs level 1 evidence? You will have to appraise it and see. You will have to check it for yourself. You get what you give. And according to one of the studies, we are poorly in telling good from bad. BMG, there was a study published in which deliberate errors were introduced in the article, and the reviewers were given to review these articles, and only 47% of the people could actually, of the reviewers could actually pick up poor randomization. So you have to evaluate the written evidence for quality assessment, usefulness, by assessing the validity, reliability, relevance, and critical importance. So validity is basically how far the results of the study are closer to the truth. Reliability and relevance and clinical importance, they are also important because whether you can apply these results to the practice or not, whether these are generalizable or not, and whether these results hold true in your scenario or not. The terms of randomization and allocation, concealment and blinding, these are applicable for the RCT. So if you, for example, if you are critically appraising an RCT, then you are probably going to look at these terms. These are one of the most important things in critical appraisal of an RCT. Another term that you should be familiar with is reporting guidelines. Reporting guidelines is basically a checklist of the items. For example, Prisma is one of the reporting guidelines. And for RCTs, the most important reporting guidelines is the CONSORT. Okay, so it's basically a checklist of the items that these procedures should have been followed before this study was complete, or these procedures should have been followed in conducting this study, in order that this study was free from bias and this was a valid study, the results would be valid and reliable if you have followed all these checklists. And if you have not followed, then probably the results may not be that good, may not be that right. So reporting guidelines is basically not only for the person who is doing that research, but also for the person who is reading that research article, that whether all these things are followed or not, whether this article which I am reading is good enough to be relied upon or not. They are different for all different types of studies, experimental studies, observational studies. They will have different set of reporting guidelines. All of them are freely available on net, on various websites such as CEBM, that is Center of Evidence-Based Medicine, and other various other websites. But you can search them for your own. So it's important that whenever the final report is published, out of these guidelines are followed so that there's a good logical structure, complete and accurate description of the study elements, and a consistent writing style. So this is one of the places where you can assess these critical appraisal tools and reporting guidelines online. Consort statement is a consolidated standard of reporting trials. This is one of the good statements for reporting of RCTs and for critical appraisal of RCTs. This is again one of the things that you will frequently see in most of the systematic review in meta-analysis. This is basically a chart that you will see in a large number of meta-analysis. This is basically Cochrane collaboration tool for assessing risk of bias. This is again valid for randomized controlled trials. And most of the authors who are using the Cochrane format, Cochrane will have a different format for writing systematic reviews. One of them is obviously, if you go to the Cochrane site, you will be able to see this format in which the Cochrane wants its authors to write the meta-analysis and systematic reviews. And this is followed for the RCTs, in which there are different elements. For example, random sequence generation, that is basically randomization. So it stands for whether there is a green is for low risk of bias, there could be an unclear risk of bias and high risk of bias. So once you reach the material and methods section of the systematic review, you will be able to comment upon this. Allocation concealment is different from blinding, is different from randomization. It's what happens between randomization and blinding, which is again important for a randomized controlled trial. And similarly, then there will be a lot of other items that forms this checklist. And basically, you should be aware. I mean, you shouldn't feel alien to this type of pictures. This is a very friendly diagram. If you see this in a systematic review, you'll be able to see how sound the studies included in the systematic reviews are methodologically, whether they have followed a good guide or not. This is adaptation of the same diagram which you may find in other systematic reviews. This again tells you the same thing. All this green plus means high quality, blank spaces means unclear risk of bias, and this red spaces means there's a high risk of bias. So you can see that out of these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 studies included, this is one of our own systematic review of one of our own meta-analysis. One of the studies, this is probably the best study, but all other studies are more or less similar, but and they have a reasonable methodological quality. Sometimes some things are not possible to be done in some studies. For example, blinding of participants and personnel. Personnel means the person performing the surgery. This is probably not possible in most of the surgical trials. Now, application of the evidence. Can I apply this evidence to my case? Would my patient meet the inclusion criteria of studies and tutorials, trials in the review? Is my patient so different to those in the study that the results cannot be applied? So whether this is basically the external validity of the study or the generalizability of the study to the population of your interest. The last thing which I would like to discuss in the meta-analysis, no discussion of the meta-analysis will be complete without discussing forest plots. So this is basically graphical representation of the meta-analysis. This is a forest of line. So again, my request would be, don't feel alien to this diagram next time you are reading a meta-analysis. If you read this diagram, this is the conclusion of the meta-analysis. You don't have to read the entire paper. You can just look at this diagram and say what are the results of your meta-analysis. Okay? So this is how this friendly diagrams looks like. And so basically, these are the studies, various studies, the numbers in the studies, the control group, whatever, and these are the effect sizes or the odds ratio which have been derived from these studies. So this part is a forest plot. This is how this forest plot is going to look like. So there's something called a line of no effect. This line at 1, this is called the line of no effect. This means that if the study, the results of this study are at this line, it is as good as a correlation coefficient of 1. I mean, there is no effect in either direction. It is neither good nor bad. These are individual studies. These horizontal lines represent the individual studies. These dark squares here represent the results of those individual studies. And the width of these dark circles or the size of these dark squares represent the weight given to that study in the systematic review or the, in the meta-analysis. Again, I want to clarify that all the studies included in the meta-analysis will not be given the same weight. They will be given weightage according to the patients and number of sample size and the effect size or the number of events happening in that study. These are the two things which will determine that how much weightage is given to that study in that particular meta-analysis. So this represents the weightage of the meta-analysis of the individual study in the meta-analysis. This represents the results of the study, that the position of this square, and the span of this horizontal line represents the confidence interval of the results of the study. This diamond at the bottom represents the overall effect size or the conclusion of your meta-analysis. Okay. This is just to summarize what I have been saying. Now, what is happening here? This is a line of no effect. This was worse, this was better. So the result of this study, this is significantly worse. This is significantly worse, but less worse than the previous one. This is significantly better. This, I am saying, may be significantly better. We are not for sure here, because this is crossing the line of no effect here. And as we discussed in one of the previous presentations, if the confidence interval is crossing the line of no effect or is crossing the central line, then it means that the p-value is not what is greater than 0.05 if you take in the cutoff as 0.05. And if it is crossing this equally on both the sides, it will just say that it's insufficient to draw any conclusion from the study. And this is the result of this meta-analysis, which is exactly at the center. The conclusion will be insufficient to draw any conclusion from the meta-analysis. Right, so any doubts about the first plot? 95% confidence intervals, just to re-emphasize what we have been discussing since morning. This is an important concept. This basically means that there is a 95% chance that if the true effect of the population will lie within this range. Okay, so if you have this results, if you are looking at this study, orange one, so there are this is a confidence interval, so there are 95% chances from this the results of this study that the actual population mean will lie within this confidence interval. Because we are studying the sample, we are not studying the population, but we are drawing inferences about the population from the sample. Second thing, if the trial is repeated again and again, 95% of the times the point estimate or the results of the study will lie within this range. So just to conclude about the meta-analysis, whenever you are reading a meta-analysis, just try to see, did the authors work according to a written protocol? Did they carefully describe the question to be answered by the meta-analysis? Did they clearly describe the research strategy? Where did they search? How did they search? Whether did they write that clearly or not? Did they evaluate the quality of the trials included in the meta-analysis or not? So quality assessment was done or not? How was the information summarized? Did they include the characteristics of the patients enrolled in the trials? I mean, the studies have to be comparable. There are no apples and oranges together. Did they use a graphical representation, that is a forest plot? Did they investigate the outcome heterogeneity? I have not gone into the heterogeneity and the meta-analysis part, because I think we basically need to familiarize ourselves to the meta-analysis first and then go into the heterogeneity and other type of analysis in the meta-analysis part. How was the overall therapeutic gain calculated, and was the population bias taken into account? So take-home message, systematic review and meta-analysis are highest levels of evidence. They follow a diligent methodology of literature search, critical appraisal and synthesis. Knowledge of critical appraisal tools and reporting guidelines will help in understanding the strength of a research paper. Thank you.